So I welcome you all to the next instruction course, which is Paradigm Shift in Microbial Keratitis. And I have a galaxy of speakers with me, which includes Dr. Samar Basak, who's the director at Deshai Hospitals, Barakpur, Kolkata from West Bengal, Professor Ritu Arora, Head Cornea Department, Guru Nanak Eye Center, New Delhi, and Professor Rajesh Sinha from RP Center for Ophthalmic Sciences, AIIMS Delhi, and Professor Titiyal, also from RP Center for Ophthalmic Sciences, AIIMS Delhi. So the other speakers would, I think, be joining us soon, and I would be talking to you about the workup of a case of microbial keratitis as well as bacterial keratitis. So to talk about bacterial keratitis, I have no financial interests or disclosures, and this is how a case of bacterial keratitis would look like. This is a classical case of Pseudomonas bacterial keratitis. And the risk factors for bacterial keratitis could be ocular, could be systemic. The ocular risk factors are such as corneal abrasion or epithelial defect, eyelid disease, contact lens use, previous ocular surgery, ocular surface disease, compromised corneas, and injudicious use of topical antibiotics, steroids, and traditional eye medicine. And there could be systemic risk factors, which include use of immunosuppressive drugs, burns, chronic alcoholism, severe malnutrition, AIDS, malignancy, rheumatoid arthritis, and extremes of age. Extremes of age meaning infancy and old age. This is a case of keratitis in a diabetic patient, and this is a case of keratitis in rheumatoid arthritis, which tends to be peripheral. Now, apart from this, there could be other causes, such as use of traditional eye medicine or honey, which is common in some of the rural areas. Then post-LASIK keratitis, you can see the flap and a buttonhole flap with the microbial keratitis, and then thinning and perforation, which can occur when topical steroids are used in cases injudiciously. The symptoms, of course, we all are aware of: redness, sensitivity to light, which is increased, or photophobia, decreased visual acuity, pain, discharge, and associated conjunctivitis. And this occurs more often when the organism is gonococci, pneumococci, and haemophilus. So whenever a case of microbial keratitis comes, howsoever small or large it may be, it is important to do a good slit lamp evaluation and to do fluorescein staining. So this is mainly to know the area and the density of infiltration, the size and depth of ulceration, the size of the epithelial defect, the degree of the stromal edema, and the scleral involvement, and anterior chamber reaction. So this is actually the size of the epithelial defect, which is staining, and the size of the infiltration is here larger than the size of the epithelial defect. So each time the patient comes, you have to monitor not only the epithelial defect, but also the size of the infiltration. And when the patient changes the position, then you can see that there is a change in the hypopyon, and this hypopyon is of course mobile, and static hypopyon is more often seen in cases of fungal keratitis. Now, important to know what is the grade of the ulcer, whether it is mild, moderate, or severe, and if it is less than 2 millimeters in size, 20% depth, superficial, then it is mild, then 2 to 5, 20 to 50%, mid stroma, then it is moderate, and if it is more than 5, more than 50% depth, deeper than stroma, then it is severe. Now this is how it would look like. It is important because that would dictate your treatment modality, whether it is bacterial keratitis or it is fungal keratitis. Now generally, it is seen that ulcers with a poor outcome are more likely to be larger, and they involve posterior cornea and have aspergillus species, or they occur in females. This is a study which just looked at the risk factors for severe microbial keratitis. Now, most of the times, you can, at least 70% of the times, pick up what the organism is. So if it's a punched out lesion like this with clear margins, with cornea which is surrounding, which is relatively clear, then most likely it is staphylococcus. And the non-edematous surrounding cornea would be there. However, if it is an ulcer like this, which is rapidly progressive, serpiginous ulcer with folds, which desmoid membrane folds, a hypopyon, and deep stromal abscess, then it is most likely to be pneumococcal. However, if it has a ground glass stromal appearance, is fulminant, greenish yellow discharge, infiltration occurs in 24 hours, ring ulcer in 48 hours, and there's within 2 to 5 days there is desmatocele or perforation, then it is most likely to be a Pseudomonas ulcer. Mycobacteria ulcers, on the other hand, have this cracked windshield-like appearance with surrounding cornea, which is quite clear. It occurs following trauma, and it is generally indolent, and there's hardly any AC reaction. You can see, again, this cracked windshield-like appearance. Moraxella ulcers, on the other hand, they tend to be inferior, they tend to be oval, there's hardly any AC reaction, and the rest of the cornea is quite clear, and it is seen more in diabetics, alcoholics, and malnourished. Nucardia is like a flower-like pattern, so wreath pattern with satellite lesions and ulcers which are indolent with elevated hyphate edges and cracked windshield appearance. Now, the limitations of the clinical evaluation is that you can pick it up only 3/4 of the times or 76% of the times. You may still require microbiology for in 1/3 of the cases. Now, having said that, if the ulcer is not responding to treatment, it is always best to do microbiology. Now, corneal scrapes are the ones which need to be done, which are the mainstay for any case of microbial keratitis. Proparacaine should be used, which is least bactericidal, and the scraping should be done from the leading edge of the ulcer as well as from the center of the ulcer. And we generally like to use a 15-degree blade, although modified Kimura spatula is what has been recommended. And the most important stains for a case of bacterial keratitis, or for that matter for any microbial keratitis, is KOH, because that will immediately tell you whether you have to start your antifungal therapy or not. And apart from this, you do Gram stain, and in cases which are recalcitrant, you do acid fast. Acid fast is done for man. Man means mycobacteria, actinomyces, and nucardia. So whenever you are suspecting man, mycobacteria, actinomyces, or nucardia, you would do acid fast stain. Now, the standard culture media which is generally used is blood agar, and also chocolate agar, and in cases of fungus, if you're suspecting fungus, always send for Sebrard's dextrose agar. And in cases of recalcitrant infections, for LJ media, for mycobacteria, and non-nutrient agar with E. coli for acanthamoeba. Then culture positivity rate for bacterial keratitis is 40 to 73%, and everything that is related to the ulcer, which includes a suture, a contact lens solution, or contact lens case, everything should be sent for culture and sensitivity. And sometimes you have interface infections like this, then you need to actually remove these sutures and send a scrape from there. And at other times, you may have infectious crystalline keratopathy, and again, after LASIK, and then you have to elevate this flap and take a scrape from there. If you may have infections after DSEC, then in those cases you have to use intravitreal biopsy scissors to take a biopsy from the posterior lenticule if the infection is there. And sometimes you have corneal abscess where there is no epithelial defect. Then you can do a short suture biopsy. That is, you take a needle with a very short suture, pass it through this abscess, and send it for culture sensitivity. Corneal biopsy is indicated in cases which are at least twice negative. For smear and culture, there's no clinical improvement, so you can do partial thickness trepidation. The tissue is removed, end block, bisected, and sent for culture sensitivity. Then in mild ulcers, which are less than 3 millimeters in size, not involving the visual axis, monotherapy should be used, which could be a fourth generation fluoroquinolone, such as a gatifloxacin or moxifloxacin. However, in moderate ulcers, which are more than 3 millimeters in size and involving the visual axis, combination therapy is used with fortified kefosiline 5% and tobramycin 1.3% to cover for gram-positive cocci and the gram-negative bacilli. Now, bacterial keratitis, you have to give loading dose. And loading dose is generally given for 48 hours, round the clock for initial 48 hours, and then you assess the clinical response. So if it is a fungal keratitis, you would give loading dose for up to 4 days and then assess the clinical response. Bacterial keratitis, if it starts to improve, would generally improve within the next 2 to 3 weeks, whereas fungal keratitis would take ordinarily 3 to 4 weeks to respond. And when you say round the clock, you mean even during the bedtime, even if the patient has to wake up and put these drops. So these are just two randomized controlled studies wherein we compared monotherapy versus the combination therapy in mild to moderate ulcers, and we found that both of them were equivalent. Another randomized controlled trial in more than 200 plus patients where we found similarly. Adjuvant therapy has to be used, which includes cycloplegics, anti-glaucoma medications, and topical steroids, which I would be telling you when to use them. And systemic antibiotics, we do prefer for cases of perforation, post-perforating injury, scleral involvement, and when the organism is Neisseria or Haemophilus. The SCUT trial, or the steroids for corneal ulcer trials, did look at the role of the steroids in cases of bacterial keratitis, and it did tell us that early use of topical steroids is beneficial when the vision is low, or when the ulcers are central, or when they are deep, and non-nocardia keratitis, severe Pseudomonas keratitis, did better with topical steroids. So in short, topical steroids should never be used in cases of fungal keratitis, atypical mycobacteria keratitis, and nocardia keratitis. Topical steroids in bacterial keratitis can be used provided you have a culture sensitivity report in hand and provided you've already loaded the bacterial keratitis of at least for 48 hours with the antibacterials. Now, the favorable signs are that there will be decrease in the area density of infiltration and there will be epithelial healing, decrease AC reaction. Unfavorable signs would be when there are other organisms and other factors which are responsible for it. Now, modify antibiotics only if there is no clinical improvement, and if there is, and taper, in fact, you should stop short the antibiotics when there are clinical signs of improvement. Now, if your culture sensitivity report says otherwise, but clinically the patient is improving, change nothing about it, because that is the best test of whether the patient is responding or not responding. In recalcitrant keratitis, when the organisms are MRSA, use vancomycin 5%, severe Pseudomonas keratitis, ceftazidime, Mycobacterium fortitum or chelone, and nocardia, amikacin can also be used. Now, these are the ways to present, to prepare the kefazolin in your clinics or in your pharmacies, and tobramycin, the concentrated drops, 5% and 1.3% respectively. And this is how you would prepare the fortified drops, vancomycin, 5%, and trimethoprim or sulfamethoxazole drops, the concentration of which is 16 mg and 80 mg per ml respectively. Topical colistin, 0.19%, has been used for cases which are resistant to everything. And again, injection colistin is available, and this can again be diluted to prepare 0.19% solution. Is useful in those cases where it is where the bacterial keratitis is resistant to all the commonly available antibacterials. This is how the healing of the corneal ulcer should be over a period of time when the ulcer converts into a scar, and the end point is that you want the scar to be less hazy, and there should be hardly any opacification when the ulcer actually heals. Now, sometimes there can be compliance issues. This ulcer was healing when the antibacterials were started, but as the patient stopped to take these antibacterials, again there is increase in the hypopyonic size of the ulcer. Of course, you can have sequel and complications such as this, perforations, thinning, adherent glaucomas, when these need to be addressed by other surgical methods of treatment for microbial keratitis. And when there's impending perforation, then one can use glue. When there is a perforation, then one can use patch graft, which could be lamellar or full thickness penetrating keratoplasty. And when there is no response, then of course to reduce the microbial load, one can do a therapeutic penetrating keratoplasty. So to conclude, early diagnosis and meticulous treatment are mandatory in cases of bacterial keratitis. Compliance and resistance are important issues in event of non-resolution. Antibacterials should be used judiciously, and surgery may be required in recalcitrant cases. So thank you for your kind attention. So I now would invite Professor Ritu Arora to give her talk on viral keratitis.
Thank you, Dr. Narmata, for giving me the opportunity to be part of this very popular course on infective keratitis. So as Narmata just finished with the bacterial aspect of it, I would be taking on the viral keratitis, and my other speakers are going to follow. So I'm going to be starting with how do we attain a right balance in viral keratitis. As we all know, that viral keratitis cannot simply be managed only by topical antivirals like acyclovir, because quite often you need topical steroids to be added to that. So how do we obtain a balance in the management? So we need a balance in diagnosis, you need a balance in the management of this condition. While keratitis per se has its own specifics, that it differs from bacterial and fungal keratitis in a sense that it is chronic, it is recurrent, you know, that's the biggest bugbear of this disease, that it is recurrent with frequent relapses. And initially it was thought that it is uncommon in developing countries, but it's not so uncommon. It leads to painful, sight-threatening infections, and it has in its own spectrum a recurring stromal and endothelial disease. It leads to morbidity. Sometimes the disease heals, but it leads to morbidity through corneal scarring and neovascularization. It affects the quality of life of patient when patients are not experiencing active infection. So unlike bacterial keratitis, which once comes with a blow and leaves a scar, this disease has its morbidity because it keeps coming and going, coming and going. And the reason behind it is that the virus is latent in trigeminal ganglion. So this is what a typical picture which we are all used to of seeing, seeing a typical dendrite like that, which you may miss if you happen to see only on diffuse light. This is why I have made a beam like that, a broad beam, when you can capture this. And this, when you see it on your typical cobalt filter, fluorescent staining, this is how it comes like. And this is the picture which I've tried to show, that once the lesion starts healing, usually within 48 hours, you can see how the dendrite starts like melting away. And ultimately, you may get nothing if we really manage it well. The clinical presentations of viral keratitis could be, it's like an infectious, it could be, and you have to be very judicious in seeing that what layer of the cornea is involved. Is it only the epithelial layer involved, stromal involved, or is it a common things, it's a combination of epithelial and stroma, or it is the endothelial involvement, or is it a uveal involvement, or is it a both uvea and cornea, or is it a neurotrophic keratitis? If it is an epithelial involvement, it is usually infectious. The virus is proliferating in the epithelium of the cornea. And this has its manifestations in the form of dendritic ulcer or a geographical ulcer. Dendritic ulcer, I've already shown you before. The stromal keratitis usually is immune-linked and does not have viral except in necrotizing part. So it may be having a disciform keratitis, it may be a necrotizing keratitis, it may be an interstitial keratitis. Endothelitis usually is again and further immune reactive, and uveitis and keratoeveitis, you don't have a virus sitting over there. Neurotrophic keratitis, the nerves getting affected. This is how a typical geographical ulcer, when a dendrite which we started with, patient missed it or it was probably not managed well, at times you have a patient coming to you with this kind of an ulcer, like an amoeboid ulcer typically present. If you really see the slit, you can see a depression there. There's minimal infiltration usually at the edges and patient is pretty symptomatic. This is the thing which I've tried to show, that once it starts healing, it just keeps getting localized and it heals with a scar like that. So as I already said, that herpetic stromal keratitis is usually an immune response to the epithelial disease. So the moment we realize it's an immune response, there comes the logic of using topical steroids in the management of epithelial disease, in stromal keratitis. And this immune response could be to the HSV, which is invading the anterior stroma, either through viral reactivation of the latent HSV in sensory nerve or the direct spread from epithelial infection. It may be non-necrotizing or necrotizing inflammation. In case the epithelium is intact, then it is usually, and with this focal stromal edema, focal or diffuse stromal edema, with anterior uveitis, which is mild and usually has KPs only in the area of affected cornea. It's the disciform keratitis, typical disciform keratitis, which we all see so very often. It's the necrotizing keratitis, which is not so uncommon. These are the corneal lesions where it is like, you may think it's like a pus in the stromal area of the cornea, and but there's a lot of necrosis, there may be ulceration and dense infiltration of the stroma. Patient usually has very poor vision in these cases. HSV DNA may be present, may has been localized, especially in necrotizing stromal keratitis. In cases, sometimes it may lead to severe inflammatory response, may lead to thinning and perforation. So this is what a typical viral stromal keratitis looks like. You may have a localized area of a corneal edema, patient just says there's a history of like 3-day, 4-day onset of fallen vision. It's only when you do a slit through that, you will see that there's a localized edema and there are present multiple KPs only localized to this particular area. So these are the two eyes of the same patient. This is the OD and this was the OS. You know, this patient, when he was operated in the left eye, he had had a graft which had been done. And in the right eye, he presented to us like this. So the diagnosis was not that way difficult for us to do, that this we are dealing with viral keratitis. This discoform keratitis, when it heals, it starts healing in the form of localizing of edema over here. And you can see the picture that what it looks like here, it starts localizing and leaving a scar in this area. This is not so uncommon. I'm warning you again and again. This is a necrotizing keratitis where we see an area where there is a scar around or maybe a bit of edema, but don't miss this area. Don't miss this area where there is a dense infiltration and you can see it's a little yellowish in look. And there is a vascularization. So it's like mixture of everything. If you do a fluorescence stain, this is how it looks like. Localized small area of a stain there because there is present an epi defect. Since one now I can diagnose it so very easily. So these kind of patients, I put them in oral acyclovir 5 times a day, 400 mg, and this is how it starts healing. You can see how the eye starts quietening down, how the edema goes down, the vascularization starts going down, and even this infiltration scar, which you can see, infiltration is going down. So we started from here and look at it. This is what we've ultimately reached. So it's like real mixture of using your oral, topical, antivirals and steroids. So you may get dense stromal infiltrates, ulceration and necrosis, and it is direct infection of the corneal stroma and very severe host inflammatory reaction is there. Then there is another form of viral keratitis where we get a diffuse stromal keratitis. Your patient may come to us with diffuse localized area of edema, maybe I shouldn't use the word localized, but the area which is involved, as you can see, it's in the form of a circle. And it's the, you can see here, the deeper layer of the cornea are more involved, and there may not be any associated epithelial lesion. They have prolonged course. So if a 50 or a 60-year-old person suddenly presents to us like this, the differential diagnosis usually goes on, am I dealing with Fuchs? Sometimes they just present to you like that. Am I dealing with Fuchs or am I dealing with viral stromal keratitis? So that's where a good slit lamp picture of yours really comes handy to know that what you are dealing with. But the hallmark out here is that usually when they have a stromal keratitis, they have an associated IOP is very high in these patients. This is another picture of a case which has a recurrent stromal keratitis. At times we get patients just presenting to us like that. So here when you really see clearly, you can see that there would be an area of scar and another area from where the peripheral area, there would be a localized edema coming on. So this is a patient might, because they get recurrent attacks, you might not have seen the patient in the first attack, second attack, comes to you at a third attack. So therefore, you may just see a scarring in an area and then edema coming. Okay. Edema coming in another form. Where sometimes, this is a fellow eye of the patient where so much of inflammation has taken place that there is occurring localized thinning. This is another patient which I have who has a recurrent stromal keratitis, multifocal, and this I've just tried to zoom it up and see that which area. So be very meticulous in your examination and don't be in a hurry to do a keratoplasty in these patients because usually the PKs don't do very well in these cases. This is another patient of mine who had, this is one night patient, who had a recurrent viral keratitis, keeps following me up, but if you really look at it, I have not done PK for this patient, and this is the pupil, through this the vision is 624 he was managing, till one day he came with further diminution of vision, and you can see that I have picked up a small dendrite in this area, you know, and further defect, treated this patient with stepped up oral antivirals, and this whole dendrite has disappeared and pupil area is like that. So it's been now good 8 to 10 years I've been following up this patient and they stay all right like that. This is a typical herpes endothelitis when they come with, you can see the KPs over here, their KPs here, and there is present a diffuse deep stromal edema. It's an immunological reaction to virus in the endothelium and we treat it by giving oral acyclovir 400 to 800 milligram 5 times a day in the acute phase with topical steroids, and then you rapidly taper it off. This is another lady who had had a multifocal done outside, and then 6 weeks later, she came with diminution of vision. So this is what she presented to us. She had regained a vision of 6-9 post-IOL and then came to us like this. She was actually having a deep stromal keratitis. We treated her with topical steroids and oral antiviral. Another form of viral keratitis is like a trophic or an indolent kind of an ulcer with a localized thinning. And when you see a case like this, please don't be in a hurry to start topical antiviral or steroids. These are the patients who actually need tarsography. And this is a major cause of development of neurotrophic keratitis. They have decreased corneal sensations, blink reflex, and tear production from damage to sensory fibers. We need lubricants, patching, tarsography, autologous plasma, and growth factor. Then only we can. So therefore, I'm again and again talking about whenever you get a corneal case, please see that which layer is predominantly affected, and your treatment has to be tailor-made according to that. So the commonest presentation, if I have to put it, is combined presentation of epithelium and the stroma. So when I get cases like that, you always must stain it. And don't be in a hurry to start topical steroids. Let it be stain negative. At times, patient may have only epithelium involved. Patient, the dendrite heals up, and 6 weeks, 8 weeks down the line, he just presents to you with stromal keratitis. That's the time when the patient needs topical steroids with antiviral cover. Antiviral needed at that stage is only OD, not five times a day. If you really load the patient with topical antiviral, he lands up with epithelial toxicity, and it becomes very difficult to differentiate whether you are dealing with epithelial lesion. Then this is another case of ours who had a simple corneal, he had a corneal scar. And I really thought that this patient probably could be having viral keratitis. There was no definite history. Because we get patients like that just say that, oh, I don't know what happened to my eye. And this was again a one-eyed patient. I did a cataract surgery for this patient. But you have to be very careful. Patient was put on topical steroids. And you can see the patient has landed up with a secondary infection. So very often, silent-looking opacity, you do a cataract surgery, glaucoma surgery, start them on steroids, the virus reactivates, and they come up with frank viral infection. So if you're suspecting that, please do it under the cover of oral antivirals. This is another patient of mine who had viral keratitis and was fine till one day he came with this localized area which was involved, which was not healing despite treating the patient with topical antivirals until he landed up with secondary infection. So if I really have to see a role of HEDS, herpetic eye disease study one, which says that topical cortical steroids significantly, they improve stromal keratitis vis-a-vis placebo with significant reduction to resolution. So here has come the role of oral acyclovir. Oral acyclovir is beneficial in early resolution of stromal keratitis when used in an adjunct 200 milligram five times a day. Statistically, results were not significant. But oral acyclovir was definitely found to have a beneficial role in the treatment of iridocyclitis. Okay. So if I really have to go, the newer drugs which are coming are valacyclovir and systemic. So this is one slide I really want. Systemic antivirals should be given in the prevention of recurrent episodes of herpetic keratitis. When valacyclovir can be used as an alternative to acyclovir, current treatment is aimed at reducing corneal scarring, and 800 milligram of acyclovir five times a day is equal to 500 milligram valacyclovir TDS. So when I have an acute reaction, recurrent, I put the patient on this kind of a treatment and then bring the patient to 400 milligram. When I'm using the thing to prevent recurrence, I use 400 milligram acyclovir BD dose. And now other drugs are available like famcyclovir. So I think, and whenever you do PK in HSV keratitis, you have to take care that there can be associated glaucoma, graft rejection, and disease recurrence in these cases. So ultimately, you need a balance of diagnosis, topical or systemic antiviral, topical steroids, topical anti-glaucoma, lubricants, and dosage of systemic antiviral. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ritu Arora, for this wonderful coverage on viral keratitis. Dr. Namrata is having three sessions in the same, three talks in the same session. I have also same. So I'm talking first, then Namrata will be coming by 10 minutes time. So by this time, if you have any question, you can actually ask Ritu.
So now you can go and take it.
Dr. Ritu, I have a comment and a question. The role of GIMSA staining to look for viral cytopathic changes, if you have someone who can look at it, and also HSV-PCR, what is your take on both of those?
See, I haven't done any HSV-PCR at my setup per se because it's a very expensive modality. And by and large, you can diagnose it very easily. I know there are places which are doing HSV-PCR. They're taking it from Aquis. But I've not felt the need for that.
And what about GIMSA?
GIMSA, yes, can be done. Okay. GIMSA definitely can be done.
If somebody knows how to look at the cytopathic changes, I think that's a good...
So
one question more. Okay. Is valacyclovir available in India?
Yes. Easily available.
Hello, okay, ma'am. One last question. Like the case you showed that there is recurrence of stromal keratitis adjacent to the previous scars. In such cases, I have seen that almost one third of those patients don't respond as readily to the oral acyclovir.
No. They need topical steroids.
Topical steroids, but do you need to add oral antivirals as well?
Yes. But when they have a thing like this, depending on the severity, I may give oral acyclovir 400 mg 5 times a day. If it's not so severe, I just keep it 400 mg BD and topical steroids.
Ma'am, sometimes they don't respond. Then is there any choice in changing to
from acyclovir? No, I do not know in what way you are saying they're not responding.
Ma'am,
you should have a proper diagram in the form of how much edema is there, how much scarring is there.
Yes, ma'am, the edema fails to change and the size of the lesion fails to change. In fact, sometimes they progress.
Then maybe it is not viral keratitis, I can tell you.
So
you're probably dealing with something else.
They have to be responsive if it is viral.
Yes, you're probably dealing with something else.
So okay, I have a comment. I have two comments actually regarding PCR. When I always do PCR in cases of where I want to do some endothelial keratoplasty in this kind of patient at the end stage of endotheliitis actually. And we have published our paper in Cornea Journal last January. And we have a protocol, and in those cases, I want to be sure that those cases PCR negative at least 1 week before the surgery.
Yeah, that's right. If they're going for surgery, yes, you have to.
Number two, the valacyclovir tablet, a lot of people has a thinking that it is costly, it is not available, but valacyclovir, you know, the cost of valacyclovir tablet is 500 milligram is only 48 rupees. What is the cost of acyclovir tablet? It is 18 rupees. So you have to take two tablets, this is 36 rupees, and this is 48, so it is not costly. And third thing is valacyclovir is the product of acyclovir. Sometimes acyclovir does not work, but valacyclovir works. Because the bioavailability of, after conversion into acyclovir in the GI system, there is five-fold increase in absorption of acyclovir form. That's why valacyclovir works better. In fact, in that series, I had three patients where it didn't respond to recurrence happened. It didn't respond to acyclovir. Patient was on acyclovir. I changed the acyclovir to valacyclovir and patient responded dramatically within 14 days. So these are the few things. Very nice presentation. And I will be talking something on fungal keratitis. This is a long going the same courses, the standard medical therapy, intrastromal and intracameral. So you know that it is mostly from the developing countries. And in the tertiary level, we always see more fungal than bacterial. But when you are in a small setup, isolated clinic, that you see a lot of primary cases actually. We see a lot of late cases. And treatment is empirical. And you know that empirical treatment always difficult, and you need more knowledge than if you have microbiology set up. So you must have all the knowledge, how it looks like, what is the difference between, what is the geographical pattern, like Fusarium, it is predominantly in South India. East India, North India, it is predominantly in Aspergillus. So this knowledge is also important. Again, that farmer, that paddy with an onion, Fusarium is more common with onion cultivating farmer rather than paddy, where the aspergillus is more common. And Everything should be kept in mind before starting empirical treatment. And the sensitive pattern of that particular area. You start empirical treatment, but you see the patient for 48 to 72 hours, then you see the response. If it doesn't, you refer to a colleague who does have microbiology support. So AIS guideline is there. There are a lot of therapeutic guidelines, so it depends on size, location, depth of infiltration, presence of hypopion at this amount, and preliminary clinical or KOH mount, which you can do in your clinic, whether KOH is positive or not. These are the list of antifungal drugs, and if you see that there are some eye drop preparation, we have actually 3 eye drops in our country, which is commercially available. We make it actually amphotericin B, but natamycin and voriconazole is commercially available. And we have some oral form is there. Oral form, these are the common oral form use. And if you see the in vitro sensitivity pattern, you see that the sensitivity pattern are different with different antifungal agent. And you have to remember those facts while you prescribing your medicine to those patients. So key points to remember that all antifungals are fungistatic in nature, except one, which is not available. Natamycin is the drug of choice for filamentous keratitis, especially fusarium. Then amphotericin B is effective against Candida and Aspergillus species, and it is not that less effective against fusarium. And fluconazole showed good activity against Candida. So role of scraping is always there. It is a must for diagnosis, for all the therapeutic, all the microbial load you will be off. And also in some of the cases, you have to do repeated scraping, maybe every third day or every second day, depending, but especially with dematiceous fungus. So initial management is monotherapy, whether the ulcer is less than 5 millimeter, 1/3 depth of hypopion and a trace of hypopion, you can start with monotherapy with natamycin is the drug of choice. And then the protocol is half an hourly, then 1 hourly next day. And depending upon the response, you can reduce. Then amphotericin B or voriconazole, then cyclobelgic antibiotic. Review initially on every second or third day, then weekly see the response, and depending upon the dose and tapering or combination therapy. You have all read this article, MART trial. They have shown that the topical natamycin is the only drug that should be used alone in case of fusarium keratitis. Voriconazole should not be used as a monotherapy. And if you see the in vitro susceptibility, again, filamentous, from that particular study, the results had come up that you can use voriconazole and natamycin in combination, and because they are the two different group, one is polyene, one is azole. Then combination therapy is important for 1-8% if the ulcer is more than 5 millimeter size, deep ulcer, and there is a lot of hypopion, scleral involvement. And maybe in some of the cases where it is not responding, then you can start. And you must know that amphotericin B and natamycin are not synergistic because they are in the same class of drug. Then role of systemic antifungal, there are some drugs that they are fluconazole, ketoconazole, itraconazole, voriconazole. Voriconazole is most expensive and a lot of side effects are there, but systemic toxicity you have to keep in mind. Then MART2 trial come, they have shown that topical nata versus topical voriconazole plus minus oral voriconazole, they have shown that oral treatment doesn't increase the rate of perforation. That way, it is not effective as we used to think that it may be more effective. The question is, how long is to continue antifungal treatment? That is a little dilemma because we see from size, we cannot see the angle, especially with filamentous fungus. So rule of thumb is continue when you think that it is healed, continue for another 2 weeks and call the patient and see whether there is any signs of recurrence, and then you can say that, oh yes, it ulcer is healed. Then the concept of targeted therapy, role of intracameral and intrastroma, lot of studies have been done, and lot of advantages, disadvantages are there. So this is typically for the those cases where epithelium is completely healed, you do not, the drug will not penetrate through the epithelium. So you have to just take out the same time you give intracameral and intrastromal antifungal agents. So indication is typically the endothelial exudates or plaque with healed ocular surface where the, and you have recommended doses of all these things are there, and there are a lot of publication, anecdotal reports, and everything are there. Some are saying that it is acting, some are saying it is not acting, but then Namrata's paper came out with RCT trial, and the paper said that intracameral ampovi doesn't offer any benefit over topical antifungal therapy when performed alone and associated with drainage of hypopion. We have some example we had tried earlier. This particular patient actually healed after 14 days, and we gave 2 injections of intracameral amphotericin B. Similarly, load of intracameral voriconazole, because of its half-life is less, so it is wise not to use intracameral voriconazole alone. So there are also several anecdotal reports. Some says that it is working, so you have to repeat it actually. So you may combine with intrastromal and intracameral some form either of these two drug, and there are different reports. Intracameral, intrastromal voriconazole for deep keratitis, ineffectiveness of intrastromal voriconazole for filamentous fungus fecus, and then again the study came that intrastromal voriconazole alone did not provide any additional benefit over topical voriconazole. This again, Namrata's group has published this paper. Then combination, as I said, this is our patient, and this particular patient, surface was complete, and this patient responded with 2 doses of combination light intracameral ampho-B with intrastromal voriconazole. So summary, you have to take a call, but the, you mind remember that the complication like uveitis, secondary glaucoma, and iris neovascularization happens, and subsequently there are a lot of bleeding happens during therapeutic PK while doing peripheral iridectomy. So these are Rajesh. One case report, and this is after DMEC interface, so you may not have to, these are the ideal cases where you give stab incision, interface wash, and give intrastromal voriconazole. So TST protocol is there. This is again by Namrata Sharma. She has a lot of works on this. And it actually says that there is an algorithm, how you'll go with it. Beautifully, it is given like that. If you see that topical natamycin alone, then systemic antifungal in some of the cases where ulcer is more than 5 millimeter, depth is more than 50%, you see the response, poor response, it goes this side, good response, continue treatment. If there is poor response, again, therapeutic PK, intrastromal, continue, good response, you continued with that combination, either natamycin and voriconazole. And again, if you have poor response, if you go and repeat the intrastromal injection, again, ultimately, one end is here, therapeutic keratoplasty. So if you have all this combination, depending upon the, your response, and you can try in your case, it is very nice. So take-home message is timely standard medical therapy is the key to success in most of the fungal keratitis. So smaller ulcer, this is monotherapy is good. But natamycin is the drug of choice for fusarium. Amphotericin B may be more effective in Aspergillus and Candida. Voriconazole is not effective in Fusarium. Combination therapy like Pauline and Azole may have synergistic action. And intracameral ampho-B may have values in deep keratitis with endoexudates, and intrastromal voriconazole does some role in candida infection, but not in filamentous fungi. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.
Thank you so much, sir, for that very comprehensive coverage of fungal keratitis. And I next request Dr. Rajesh Sinha to give his talk on acanthamoeba keratitis. If there are any questions for Dr. Basak, because he has to leave, we can take it up now. No, on fungal keratitis, if you want to ask anything, rest of the questions we can take later.
Prophylactic, that is a big question, and that is actually a tough question. So normal saying heads 6 months, but this 21 patient I reported, many of them are going for 18 months. One patient is going for 2 years, so it may be lifelong. Some of the patient, it may be lifelong. I have discussion with James. He has a lot of work with. But see, some of the cases, you have to give lifelong. Only you have done a beautiful surgery, and then the problem started. Once recurrence happened, you again treat them with therapeutic doses. Now you have to keep the patients for prophylactic dose for lifelong. So you have to do KFT, LFT, and all these parameters, systemic taking. So one valacyclovir, once a day, one of my patients getting for 2.5 years. Nothing happened, but patient graft is doing good. So these are the things. So heads is one thing long time back, but individual patient, you have to take the call, and you have to discuss the patient. You have to come again and again and again, because we do not have other than these two medicine, nothing is there.
And it's quite safe. I can tell you, it's very safe drug.
Very safe drug.
So if you give them lifelong, nothing happens actually. I have patients now going over 5 years, 6 years just taken. It's okay.
No.
Rajesh.
I thank Dr. Namrata Sharma for having me in this course. I'll be talking about acanthamoeba keratitis. Fortunately, it is not that common as we see other types of keratitis. However, if it occurs, it can have devastating outcomes. And there are various risk factors. It has been seen, noted, that many of these are contact lens users, but mostly those who don't maintain the contact lens properly, like use tap water or homemade saline, etc., for washing and cleaning. Those are more at risk of acanthamoeba keratitis, and particularly those who get an injury and then some contamination by any contaminated water. Then, because this amoeba is a free living in contaminated water, so that's why the risk factors are these. It is typically unilateral, has severe pain, and that is why it is said that the symptoms are more than the signs that you get, and it is seen mostly in immunocompetent patients. And if the patient is immunocompromised, like diabetics and HIV positive, in such cases you can have a painless acanthamoeba keratitis as well. And many a times it is diagnosed in the end when all the other methods have failed to clinch your diagnosis. So then people start thinking in terms of acanthamoeba keratitis. As I said, the symptoms are quite high. Pain is severe in these patients, and redness, photophobia, blurring of vision, just like any other keratitis, the patient can have these symptoms. Typically seen, it starts with the epithelial irregularity and the dendrite-like appearance, but these are pseudodendrites. Why I said, because the normal dendrites have terminal bulbs, but these dendrites are pseudodendrites because they don't have terminal bulbs. Many times, you don't get to see it. Similarly, typically, pathognomonic is radial perineural infiltrate, as you see here, and patchy infiltrates, but you have to be extremely lucky to have an acanthamoeba keratitis at that stage in your clinic, because most of the times they come and they have a ring infiltrate, and it is quite severe, and sloughing also can happen. Now, if you have a ring infiltrate, something like this, then you just have to see what is the duration of the keratitis. If it's very rapidly occurring, then you think more in the lines of Pseudomonas. But if it's, it has taken a little bit lesser virulent course, then you can think in the form of Acanthamoeba keratitis, which is typically seen this kind of a ring infiltrate in Acanthamoeba keratitis. It has a slow progression, as I said earlier, that if you have a very rapid progression with a ring infiltrate, you think something else. But it has typically not very fast progression, and typically it does not have any corneal neovascularization, except if there is a scleritis, you can have neovascularization. And if you have a mild to moderate scleritis, you can have something like this, vascularization at the limbus, and the patient is having pain. But sometimes you have very severe scleritis. This is one of my patients who had an Acanthamoeba keratitis following PRK. And this patient had severe scleritis. You can see here, this is, you know, thinning of sclera. So normally in this patient, what happened, that there was a fleeting kind of scleritis. Nodule formation was there, then it atrophied, then there was adjacent nodule, again it atrophied, and that's how there was a 360 degree thinning of sclera that was seen, and that can be seen in severe scleritis in Acanthamoeba keratitis. Now, as far as diagnosis is concerned, we do corneal scraping just like in any other keratitis. ConfoScan is something which is, for Acanthamoeba, it is quite dependable. And many times, these patients are diagnosed based on ConfoScan pictures. So you get thick nerves, as you can see here. These are thickened nerves. As you move further anteriorly, you can see the double-walled cysts. As you can see here, these are double-walled cysts. And as you move further anteriorly in the basal epithelium, basal layer of the corneal epithelium, you get these refractile trophozoites. So all these features, for Acanthamoeba, confocal is really important. That gives you diagnosis. Apart from that, the double wall cysts, which stain very well with this calcofluor white, apple green fluorescence that is seen, that can be seen in if there are cysts that are visible. As far as culture is concerned, the scraping is put on a non-nutrient agar with live or killed gram-negative bacilli. And typically, you get to see depressions in the culture plate. These are called trails. But you can get depressions in culture plate even with the neutrophils and other phagocytes, because they eat up the E. coli, and then they are depressions. But on serial transfer, these lymphocytes and phagocytes, they die. But these Acanthamoeba, if there's Acanthamoeba, then there will be trails in the serial transfer of the next plate as well. So that is how we differentiate between Acanthamoeba and contamination. Then PCR is something which is very important. It really helps. It has a very high sensitivity and specificity. And once you are through with the diagnosis, sometimes you don't get by investigation. Sometimes you manage with ConfoScan. Sometimes you manage with clinical. But the best thing is that you should have a proven diagnosis, and once you are through with it, you start the treatment. And a combination therapy is the key that is done. Combination of bigonide 0.02% and dimidines propamidine 0.1% is what we give. Apart from that, intensive therapy initially, and then you reduce. Apart from that, you can give systemic azoles, oral voriconazole, 200 milligram twice a day, can be very useful in these cases. A new drug that is anti-Leishmania drug is miltefosine, which is now being used and has been used in animal studies with good results. And there are a couple of case reports of single cases wherein they have used it as an adjunctive, as an additive therapy. You have to continue with PHMB, but if you give additive miltefosine, it can work better. Then steroids can be used to reduce inflammation. Many of these Acanthamoeba keratitis, they have uveitis. So apart from the viral keratitis wherein you get inflammation in anterior chamber, in Acanthamoeba also you get. So steroid helps in these cases. It should be given under cover of bigonides. And if you have scleritis, again, you have to give steroid. In scleritis, mycophenolate mofetil is very useful. The dosage is you start with a 500 milligram twice a day dosage, then you increase over a period of 4 to 5 days time to 1 gram twice a day, and then you further increase to 1.5 gram twice a day, and this is how you continue. Supportive therapy, as in any other keratitis, is useful. Just a few case reports on efficacy of CXL and phototherapeutic keratectomy has been reported, but it is still not an established modality. And penetrating keratoplasty is the last resort, but in acanthamoeba, if you do penetrating keratoplasty in the earlier stage, then the recurrence is very high, so in the graft. So it's always better to control the infection to some extent and then go ahead with a keratoplasty. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you so much, Rajesh. And can you please join us on the dais? I would now request Professor Tityal to give his talk on therapeutic keratoplasty, and after that it is going to be an open house, so you all can ask whatever questions you want to ask.
Thank you, Professor Sharma, for giving me this opportunity to be such a gamut of people sitting with the cornea services, holding the entire country together. You heard various disorders of bacterial, fungal, acanthamoeba. Despite having a good medical management, good diagnosis, sometimes you have to resort to a surgical treatment for these patients. If you look into the goal of surgery in these patients is basically, first is to remove the entire infective tissue as far as possible and maintain the structural integrity of globe. If possible, rehabilitate these patients also with the same graft. So these are three important things which are we are looking for. The fourth important thing is we have to get a tissue for either for a histopath or a culture sensitivity. Because if I see my own cases or in the RP center, almost 40% of cases where they undergo therapeutic keratoplasty do not have a culture sensitivity beforehand. So if you have a patient where you don't get a good culture, they are the cases likely to have a surgery in subsequent treatment. So that you will get from a histopath examination of these cases. And see how we do surgery in these cases. The timing of surgery and the actual selection of patient is very important for a successful keratoplasty in these patients. So this is what we look for surgery, good exposure, and at least 1 millimeter larger than the diseased tissue, sharp definition because you have a softer eye in most cases, especially a perforated ulcer. Look for a clear exudation for anterior chamber, defer the lens surgeries, vitrectomy needed should be automated, at least few PI so that you don't have a pupillary block. Subsequently, you're going to have an inflammatory membrane in these patients. So this is from Dr. Rajesh's surgery, which I'm going to show here. I'll just go back here. So if you see the basic surgical technique here, you can see this is a perforated corneal ulcer. You can see a large perforation here. The idea is to have a good definition. See, the entire area should be seen. The inferior edge should also be seen. You can see at least 1 millimeter larger. Dr. Rajesh has taken for taking out the entire infective area. So make sure you delineate the area of infection, then take a definition, then go a partial definition first, then entry with the blade so that you don't damage the underlying structures. Because this is normally you have a flat chamber in these cases. If you go very sharp, you might damage the iris or lens also. Take out the entire tissue first. Make sure all the inflammatory members are taken out. Sometimes by the time you come back again, the membrane forms again and again in these inflammatory cases. So sometimes I should use heparin solution in these cases to decrease the inflammatory membrane. And make sure you remove from the underlying the host area, because sometimes infiltration may be beyond the host area in these cases. As I told, always go for an interrupted suture for these patients, because the healing can be totally differential in different areas. You may have to have a loose sutures, which may require a replacement subsequently. So it is very important to have a surgical aspect for these patients. And see what is the next important area I was talking about. Around 12 to 70% of cases where you don't have a responsive treatment may require a therapeutic keratoplasty. So what are these indications where we have to do surgery for these patients? The first indication would be a perforated corneal ulcer like this, or you have a non-healing ulcer for a long, long time. The ulcer which is reaching up to the scleral area, don't wait for this to happen in your patients. Absolutely chronic case, impending perforation, and you have a patient with thin cornea or a fistula in these cases. So these are cases where you may have to do keratoplasty in these cases. The important thing for a decision making for our patient is I would always say do a detailed examination for your patient, especially look for perforation, endothelitis, limbal involvement, and the antibiotic cover should be continued with these patients. Most importantly, I see the perfect documentation has to be there for your patient. Whichever surgery you are doing, let it be keratoplasty, either you draw with your hand in your paper, take a good photograph, then documentation has to be perfect. As we discussed in the morning, previous lectures, anterior segment OCT will delineate the depth of your ulcers. The good confocal microscopy will do a pictures also, but whatever you draw in the paper is also a legal document for you. And counseling of patient is important. Apart from that, the counseling of relatives is also very important. Because sometimes they'll say they had a better vision than before surgery. So these are people who they make life difficult for us. So don't look into patient only, look for relatives also for your cases. Always go for good quality donor tissue because that can give you a visual rehabilitation also. The progression of disease, assessment of anterior chamber is better with the clear corneas. But some cases where you don't have opportunity to have a good cornea, you can use any cornea which is available with you. It can be a cryopreserved or glycerin preserved also. You can replace subsequently after infection goes off, or you can do a subsequent secondary optical graft for these patients. Surgical technique I've showed you earlier, but most importantly, if this is ulcer, I have, so I'll go at least 1 millimeter larger than this. And once I cut the tissue, this half of tissue goes for histopathology, and one fourth goes for bacterial ulcer, or one fourth goes for fungal culture. Or you can send it for other investigations also, not only these three things. So this gives an opportunity for a proper diagnosis. You can change the medication subsequently for your patients. So this is what you see in these patients. As I said, timing is very important. You can see this is the ulcer which localized to the central 7 millimeters, little hypopyon. This is after 6 months. This is after 1.5 years. So this patient had response to your keratoplasty for an infection, as well as had optical rehabilitation also. You can say this is a patient who has a huge ulcer here. The chances of ocular graft is very impossible. This is after 2 weeks of surgery. This is after 6 months. You can see central opacity, but still we could manage this patient very, very nicely. So this is a case which is early enough. You can say results will be better, but sometimes because these patients are having a chronic disease, inflammation, the epithelial growth can be difficult with the low grade, low optical quality tissue you have used. The epithelial defect has to be managed very nicely for these patients. Stain your every cornea of your patient before, after surgery also. And this is a large ulcer, the bound to fail subsequently. A small ulcer, this will do better. This is immediately after surgery. And this is after 6 months. This is another patient with a huge ulcer. Timely surgery, immediately after surgery. This is after 1 year. You can see a clear graft. If you do appropriate surgery in a proper time, you'll always achieve a good result for your patients. We always look into recurrence for these patients. And this is, you can see how it goes. If you have a recurrence, appropriate treatment should be done early enough. Fungus is the one which will have a maximum recurrence. These are various important points which you have to see. Always look for what was the etiology to begin with, what was the size of ulcer, what type of other systemic factors, a diabetic patient, immunocompromised patients, intraoperative difficulties, like you had a lens extrusion, vitrectomy done, or you had a freehand dissection, there you have more chances of recurrence happening for these patients. So this is what indication of lamellar keratoplasty. It can be done also, but mostly it is for acanthoma keratitis as such. I think this is the most important slide for this particular presentation. What should we be doing after we do surgery for these patients? For bacterial keratitis, antimicrobials should be started before surgery and continue at least 1 or 2 weeks after surgery. For fungus, we have discussed this, you have to continue for at least 6 to 8 weeks after your surgery also. Maybe more than that because sometimes you do have infection running in these patients. Viral keratitis may not have a role for a topical medication, but systemic, yes, full dose for at least for 1 week, then 400 milligram BD if you have acyclovir for at least 6 months to 12 months for your patients. For acanthoma, you have to use for a very, very long time, for more than 1 year. And I think if you look into other... your time is up. I'll just go into the steroids one because that is a question people keep asking after keratoplasty. When should we use steroids for these patients? For bacterial keratitis, you can use immediately because you have taken care of an entire infective load. And those patients where you have a good culture sensitivity report beforehand, you can always use steroids under cover of your own examination. Fungal keratitis, you may have to wait for some time. Look for a no recurrence for at least 1 or 2 weeks. Once it is epithelized, everything is well controlled, you can start steroids in these cases also. Viral keratitis, it can be given safely within a day after surgery. For acanthamoeba, again, these cases you have to be a little cautious, especially in those patients where you have more inflammation, you may start steroid to begin with. As I said, all keratoplasty patients are normally indoor patients. They're under direct supervision of yours. If you start steroid, see them every day, you can change the entire medication subsequently in these patients. Cycloplegics, tear substitutes, and anti-glaucoma medication will be necessary for all cases, routine keratoplasty as well as for a therapeutic also. But in looking into outcome-wise, all cases would do well after surgery, but bacterial keratitis will be doing our best in these cases. This is Dr. Namata's publication. You can see almost 100% cure rate in a fungal and viral keratitis, in bacterial and viral. But if you fungal one, they're the one difficult one to treat. The success rate is less than 60%. You may require a repeated surgery for these patients. That's why I said in the beginning, good documentation and counseling is very important for these patients. This is some special situation. Infection after lamellar keratoplasty is difficult. Same holds with the DSEG or DMEG cases. You may have to do a full thickness keratoplasty in these patients. Post refractive, again, very difficult to treat sometimes in these patients. Like this is one of our patients who started with a small ICK type of picture. Ultimately, we had to do a good big therapeutic graft for these patients. So once you have an interface infection, first thing is to lift the flap and scrape the area. If flap is melting, you take away the flap, sacrifice the flap. That's how you can control the infection. Never try to replace the flap in these cases. This is another patient of mine where I started with a patient started with a small infection increase. I did a lamellar keratoplasty dark in this patient. For 6 weeks, patient was all right. Then again, recurrence happening in this patient. Ultimately, patient required a full thickness therapeutic graft. So doing a lamellar keratoplasty may be a good option, but make sure what type of disease you are looking for. Acanthamoeba, maybe yes. Fungus, I'm not sure. You should not be doing lamellar keratoplasty. But cases with LASIK patients where you have an infection which is normally by atypical organisms, lamellar keratoplasty may not be a good idea in a patient who is not doing well with the initial treatment. I think that in a small perforation, you can do a patch graft. This is one concept I had for a patient with fungal keratitis. If you use a donor tissue which is cross-linked, maybe that does better in these cases in terms of preventing a recurrence happening in these patients, or acceptance are better. This is one of two of my patients. You can see a fungal keratitis requiring keratoplasty. We use a cross-linked cornea and did very well subsequently at 3 months, 6 months, 1 year. People can use this concept for the therapeutic keratoplasty also. I think this is the summary of these cases. Therapeutic keratoplasty is an option for almost 20% of all cases coming with the infectious keratitis. Once done in appropriate time, you have a good result for these patients. Bacterial, almost 100% cure rate. Same for a viral. Fungus, almost 60%. And always look for a patient with a good post-op treatment and post-op follow-up. Glaucoma is one of the major problems in those patients where infection has been under control. So always look for a glaucoma for your patient of all keratoplasty. Thank you for your kind listening. Again, I'd like to thank my own National Eye Bank and my entire team of cornea units.
Thank you so much, sir, for that wonderful presentation. And now, if there are any questions or any doubts, all of us are here to sort out whatever we can.
No, sir. After therapeutic keratoplasty, many a times we see pus is forming. So what precaution we should take to prevent it? And if it is formed, how to manage it?
If it is your graft is clear, only the anterior chamber you have a hyperpion reoccurrence in these patients. This patient can be managed by your topical and systemic medications. Suppose it is a fungal infection, I'll continue my antifungal systemically as well as topically in these patients, and maybe that gets controlled. If the hyperpion is increasing and having a posterior plaque happening in these patients, then maybe intracameral can be given. Like same treatment you heard before with Dr. Basak can be initiated in these patients. But if I see the graft is getting infected, the first thing would be I replace the graft immediately, because that will take off the load again. But if it's just the intracameral, I'll wait for some time.
No, I am asking about pus, peripheral anterior synechia.
Okay, I'm sorry, I thought it's pus. We're looking for pus. Pass is pass, you know. The peripheral anti-synechia would form in all cases with therapeutic grafts, major cases, especially where you had a difficulty in surgery. That's why I said you should put at least one or two PIs in different areas. So one can be superior, one can be inferior, or there can be two superior PIs, because that's an important area. But that might prevent your pass formation.
One more thing I think is important in this, and we've described this, sir, is oversized graft in these cases. So oversize it by 1 millimeter rather than 0.5, which you would do customarily, because iris has a memory. So if once it starts to come in front, then you know it has a memory, you do another graft, it'll again try to come up. That's so the best thing is used oversized graft, and that has been published in ophthalmology.
Irrespective of size of graft, we should oversize by 1 millimeter?
Yes,
1 millimeter.
1 millimeter.
Okay.
And if these cases have a lot of fibrinous exudation.
Yeah.
And the pass forms because of fibrinous exudation. So therefore, what Dr. Tatyaz said was right, that maybe two or maybe at times I do 4 PIs. But see to it, they are reasonably big. Otherwise, they get occluded. So if they are big, then they serve the purpose. Yeah.
Don't try to intervene immediately, because eye is totally inflamed. So you try to relieve the synechia, this will reform again. Maybe wait for a little, inflammation to get under control. Your graft is clear, things are all right. You may take a subsequent surgery to sweep the, pass subsequently after everything is under control. If it would have been a primary surgery, I would have taken immediately to the OT and released the synechia. That's the difference.
My other question is regarding viral keratitis. If we are planning for therapeutic keratoplasty, what precaution we should take preoperatively and postoperatively to prevent the recurrence?
No. In viral keratitis, as I told you, in acute stage, never do that.
No. If it is healed viral keratitis,
if it is healed, then it is not therapeutic. Then it becomes an optical PK.
Yeah.
Okay. So if I am going to do an optical PK in a healed viral keratitis, so I will see if the other eye is normal.
Okay.
Again, I am very conservative here, and if this eye patient has vision of 636, 624. I may not go in, okay? But if it's a dense opacity, heavily vascularized, I may like to give some steroids before, and then put the patient on top, oral acyclovir 400 mg BD, before, at least for a week to 10 days, before I take the case for keratoplasty.
Okay, and postoperatively we should continue that?
Oh, it will continue, as he rightly said, maybe lifelong.
Okay.
Lifelong.
In stromal keratitis due to in viral keratitis, can we give oral steroids?
There is no role of. They usually respond to topical steroids full strength under, and you can give oral acyclovir.
If there is keratouveitis, should we give oral steroids?
I have never given. It has oral steroids in keratouveitis.
I think oral steroids don't have much role.
They don't have much role.
But Rajesh, just one question. What about giving steroids in acanthamoeba keratitis? Because sometimes these patients have such a severe inflammation,
Absolutely, sir. Yeah. So that's why, because apart from viral keratitis, the inflammation in anterior chamber is seen more often in acanthamoeba, and that is why sometimes people get confused also whether it's viral or acanthamoeba. So we should give steroid in such cases under bigonide cover. And we can give topical steroid, and if there is scleritis, then in that case we should give systemic steroid or mycophenolate mofetil. So mycophenolate has a typical dosage schedule that we have to start with 500 milligram twice a day, then in another 4 to 5 days we increase it to 1 gram twice a day, and then to 1.5 gram twice a day.
Okay. Do people here have access to anti-acanthamoebal treatment?
These bigonides, you can prepare yourself. It's 20% solution that is available. The company is Arch. This is what our pharmacy gets from. And the name, the brand name is Cosmosil. And you can get a 10 ml vial as well. And that has 20% PHMB. So you can dilute it and make it 0.02%.
Thank you, Rajesh. Question?
Sir, in one of your photographs, you showed a decentered graph. Like if it is a non-healing infectious ulcer, which is slightly decentered, whether we should center our graft on the cornea or on the infectious part?
I think you have a good memory, photography memory. Because we understand keratoplasty, when you are doing optical purpose, it should be central graft.
Yes.
There we can avoid the opacity in periphery. But if you are looking for infection, you have to take away the entire infective load. So you have to go beyond the infective area. So most of the time you will have eccentric and large graft in therapeutic cases. So don't leave the peripheral area. There you have to take the entire infective area.
And therefore it becomes important when you are doing keratoplasty eccentric to do a peritomy there. Peritomy, and because when you will pass sutures through that, otherwise that area is going to bleed. So if you're doing inferior eccentric, I'll do 3 clock hour peritomy, might cauterize the conjunctival vessel, and then do the sutures.
Sir, in dendritic ulcer with epithelial defect naturally, which steroid you suggest, FML or paracetate or dexamethasone?
If it's a dendritic ulcer, stain positive, no topical steroid.
No. In stromal, with no epithelial defect, but
if there is no epithelial defect, I first start with diluted steroids.
With
steroids? Diluted steroids, I may start with FML or I may start with loteprednol.
Up to how much dose?
QID.
Thank
QID.
You.
But I will call the patient definitely at 48 hours to see. You know, so no defect has taken
within
place.
48 hours.
Sir, can you please repeat that how to obtain that biguanide
and
PHMB?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I missed
it. It is actually the name of the vial, the trade name is Cosmosil. Sir?
She can record your voice.
Okay. Yeah. So the name is Cosmosil, the company is Arch. And it prepares, you know, from 1 liter to 10 ml of vials also. So you can get a 10 ml vial, and that is 20% biguanide. So that has to be diluted to make 0.02%. You can do it with the artificial tear.
Actually, yeah, we have one more question. Yeah.
Supposing there's a case of purulent conjunctivitis, and second day he develops SPK also, and we have been given Vigamox eye drop to him, and on the second day I plan to decide not to take the headache over me, and I decide to refer him to RP center. So what will be the legal implications of it later on? If supposing the condition further deteriorates, then will he come back to me for any legal complications or not?
The question will be answered by Dr. Rajesh Sinha. He gets the maximum referral.
Can you just repeat your question, sir?
He's saying if the patient has a purulent conjunctivitis,
yeah,
along with that develops SPK, which is not responding, he refers the patient to RP center,
yeah,
or patient worsens or improves, would you refer back the patient to the initial referral surgeon? After treatment?
No, sir, not that. My question, my thing is like this, then normally we see the patient, and if the patient is deteriorating and not improving, then second or third day, we shift him to the RP center.
That's true.
Okay.
Yeah. We take care.
He doesn't come back to us.
Yeah.
But if the, supposing the things deteriorate further more ahead, and there is serious complication with him, will he point out at me also at one stage or not?
No.
Especially sir, when I've written
it doesn't, only. It doesn't happen. All the blame, everything is goes to RP center only, because we are the people who are taking care of those group of patients. Don't worry about that.
You normally take care
of those people, and after treatment, everything is all right, then we send the patient back to you only. And subsequent management, you can do subsequently also.
But you have done your work, that you started the treatment and you referred to a tertiary care center. So that is the correct way if it's not working, if it's not responding. But, however, you can still be, you know, involved, you can be a party in that litigation.
I will take the opportunity of thanking RP Center for this. I am Dr. Pradyuman. I was working at Blanchard, and for last 36 years, whenever the corneal patient deteriorates, I have been referring to Dr. V.K. Dada, Dr. Tetial, and Dr. Namrita.
Thank you so much.
Very grateful to him.
We are from your city. She is from Aligarh. I am from near Lucknow only.
So we are from the same place, and thank you for highlighting that.
Yeah, and I think once the patient comes to us and we do a therapeutic PK, then anything that has been done by the previous physician is undone. So it's like an umbrella, you know. So, I mean, everything then comes on us. Thank you so much, and I think the next people are already there for their session, and I would like to thank all the speakers, all the delegates who attended the course, and looking forward to seeing you again next year in the same course, but we'll make it more interactive. Thank you.